Good morning and welcome to the 11th meeting of the Education, Children and Young People Committee in 2024. We have apologies this morning from Ross Greer. Our first item on our agenda is an evidence session on the Children and Young People's Commissioner Scotland's Strategic Plan 2024-28. And can I welcome Nicola Colleen, the Children and Young People's Commissioner Scotland, Nick Hobbs, Head of Advice and Investigations, and Gina Wilson, who is Head of Strategy, Children and Young People's Commissioner Scotland. Morning all. I'd like to invite the Commissioner to make a brief opening statement, which I understand will include a video clip highlighting how children and young people helped develop the strategic plan. Thank you, Nicola.
Good Welcome. Morning. Thanks, Convener, and to the committee for inviting us here to share with you our strategic plan and how children and young people across Scotland have helped us to shape this. I feel very fortunate in the timing that I've been appointed into the role of Commissioner, just before the UNCRC Act was passed by this Parliament, and a time of major reforms in many areas that should continue to develop and enhance children's rights in Scotland. I also feel fortunate to have come into the role 6 months before we were required for a refreshed strategic plan to be laid in Parliament. This provided a really unique opportunity to work with the team and children and young people to look back at what has been achieved and forwards at what more is required to be done. As hopefully you'll see, this plan has the voices of children and young people throughout it. It's guided and influenced heavily by their priorities. And I want to take the opportunity to thank all of the children, young people and adults who've supported them to contribute in many ways to the plan. Throughout the session this morning, I'm looking forward to sharing in more detail how children and young people shared their views and opinions in multiple different ways with us, and what we will begin to take forward as key pieces of work around about the themes in there. But firstly, we wanted to start by showing you this film that illustrates how children and young people have been involved.
Welcome to the new plan from the Children and Young People's Commissioner of Scotland. It tells you how and what the Commissioner will be working on over the next 4 years.
In it, the Commissioner commits to work hard to make sure all children enjoy their rights and to challenge adults who make important decisions to keep their human rights promises. The Commissioner created resources for children and young people to tell the Commissioner what they thought through a special survey, taking part in workshops and running events for adults who work for children.
To come up with the plan, the Commissioner worked with young people all across Scotland, in communities, in clubs, in schools and online. The team made a special effort to work with children and young people who don't always get a chance to take part and have their opinions heard. They took part in lots of different activities, discussions, artwork, music and games. It was lots of fun.
If we were a commissioner for a day, we would make a safe space in school in which everyone can access in case they are struggling with anxiety, stress, mental health challenges or additional support needs. To this, we would make it compulsory that schools have a dedicated room for people to go to for support. Perhaps a sensory room which is accessible to all who are struggling to cope and need a break from school or just need someone to vent to. We would also make schools more accessible for those with disabilities by installing support and infrastructure. Young people from Northfield and Tory.
If I was commissioner for a day, I'd make sure that within schools, particularly secondary schools, life skills such as personal finance and just more relatable skills for, you know, further education and moving out of home.
So I think teachers should be more patient. And also, like, allow people to have their space.
My school doesn't have flash for the people.
It's no flashing lights. Only alarms for you.
That's for the people who don't have the break time or next class.
No bells.
One time, but I need flash. Because other my friends have peonies or organ plants. They're like, is it one shine or... when we're doing the load. Like, I'd be like, for them. Because they need to know next period, oh, long time of break time. They need to know.
Blackboard has is A E I O.
A-E-I-O-U.
That.
Could you sing that? Do you know to sing that?
A-E-I-O-U.
A-E-I-O-U. Is that right?
Yeah.
Can we all try that together?
Yeah.
A-E-I-O-U.
Thank you. This is just a tiny snippet of the many, many children and young people who contributed in different ways. So I look forward to sharing more about that and how those views have shaped our plans. Thank you for listening to that.
Thank you very much, Nicola. We're going to move straight to members' questions. And can I bring in, to start off this morning, Liam Kerr, please?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. It's a very ambitious and comprehensive plan. And you've set out a number of outcomes, understandably so. How will success be measured in relation to achieving this plan?
Thank you. It's absolutely our responsibility to be ambitious as possible for children and young people. I think that's a really key part of the role. So I'm glad that you recognise that. And within the next 4 years, our ambition, you know, we will be extremely ambitious for children and young people across the plan. In terms of measuring impact, I thought it could be helpful to actually reflect on some of the ways that the office has done that over the past few years, but also how we will do that moving forward as well. So I'm going to pass to Gina quickly to talk about some of the historic ways that we've measured impact, and then I'll cover off how we're going to look at that moving forwards.
Great. Thank you for the question. So there is no one way in which we measure impact with the work that we do, because we do so many different types of functions. So whether we're trying to influence law, policy or practice, whether we're trying to improve children's involvement and participation in decision making. So we use a range of different tools. If I can turn to maybe legislation and policy impact first. During the last term, the last commissioner's term, we were very focused on legislative change. The former commissioner had three main priorities. One was around UNCRC incorporation, the other was around the age of criminal responsibility, and also equal protection from assault. So the way in which we measured our success was to what degree we were able to influence the legislative change in all three of those areas. Two of them, I think we can say we were quite successful. The age of criminal responsibility, we're not quite where we want to be, but we've certainly made progress on it. We also look at how we're viewed internationally. So we work as an office with a lot of the UN human rights treaty bodies and other international organisations. If I can use as an example our work over the last 2 years to influence the last general comment on a right to healthy environment, our office was able to bring the voices of very young children into a global stage. And we were recognised for developing an engagement process, which was good practice and hadn't been done elsewhere. So we brought really young voices from Scotland into a global piece of work that's now there to provide advice to everyone on what we should be doing around a right to healthy environment. We also work directly with children and young people to ask them for their ongoing and constant feedback about the way in which we work and whether it's whether they find it effective. So if I start with maybe our own young advisors group. So we have a standing group of young advisors at the moment. We have 25. And we ask them constantly to reflect on the way in which we are delivering our work. So are we meeting the objectives we've said we're going to? And how do they find it to work with us? And we're constantly evolving the way that we do work with them based on their feedback. Not everything does work, and we do respond to that and change our practice. We do try to reach out much more broadly to other children and young people as well to ask them whether work that we have done has actually made a difference to them. So I'm thinking about children and young people who are in secure care experienced children and young people. Are they aware of our work? Has it made any difference to them? We ask them for feedback on that as well and try to reflect that in the work that we do moving forward. We also provide a lot of expert input into professional conferences. So we try to influence influence practice, and we're then often provided with feedback about the level to which that's been taken on board. So whether that's in health or education or justice, we'll provide expert input and then often be responded to afterwards to say, well, this is what we've done with what you've told us, so we can see the line between our work and the evidence and impact.
Do you want to come back in, Nicola?
Is it helpful for me to touch on a couple of the additional pieces of ways that we're going to measure impact over the coming year?
I would think the committee would benefit, yeah.
Yeah. So as Gina mentioned there, a focus of the office over the past few years has been looking at legislative changes and measuring impact and how we have contributed towards that, because often we're doing that alongside many other contributors. But as we're moving into implementation, quite a lot of our focus over the next few years will also look at practice and actually how are young people experiencing and enjoying all of their rights in Scotland, and how is that being impacted by the incorporation of UNCRC. So one of the ways you'll see within the plan that we focus quite a lot on action research. So we will very much be focusing over the next few years and making sure that through action research, commissioned research and continuous feedback from groups of children and young people across Scotland, we will be gathering ongoing, real live insights from young people to say, actually, how are you experiencing your rights around about these thematic areas that we've identified? And we're going to be publishing an annual piece of work which will share those insights from children and young people across Scotland. So some of what you saw in that snippet there, the insights that children and young people have shared have been so useful, so meaningful and so helpful. A big part of our office's role is to ensure that we've got that live, truthful data about what's really happening for children and young people in Scotland. So we'll be doing that through action research across the year, and we'll be publishing annually to say, actually, this is what we've managed to gather, this is what children and young people have told us, and viewing long term whether we're seeing progression throughout that.
McGuire, I would like to come in on a supplementary on that theme before we progress forward.
Yeah. Thank you, convener. Good morning, panel. I just listening to you, Gina Wilson, talk about getting feedback from young people. Just to delve into that, could you talk to some of the things that your office have changed based on the feedback of those young people, some specific examples?
Yeah. So specifically on our young advisors group, the last few years we had around 40 young advisors, and we'd split them into three different groups, and they were doing specific pieces of work. One of the group was helping us with our own internal governance work, one of them was working on a European project, and another group were working on our mental health investigation. And the young people fed back to us that some of them felt like they were getting much more interesting opportunities than the others, which I think was fair enough, because some of the work is a little bit drier, if I can be quite candid. Some of it sounds a lot more interesting to them. They also felt like they weren't able to bond with all the other young people that were part of the other groups and felt like they might be missing out on some of the learning from the experiences they were having. We did try to see if we could bring them all together to do work collectively, but it didn't really work because they hadn't built relationships together. They hadn't had enough opportunities to do that as one collective. So we've changed the way that we're offering our support to young advisors now. They are all one main group, and we're developing a whole training programme that we're going to offer to them so that they can develop skills in the areas that they're specifically interested to. So they can still go into subgroups if they want to, but we're not going to divide the group in its entirety, and we're going to offer them better support and training opportunities, because that's probably something that some of them lacked confidence in, so might not have put themselves forward for opportunities because they weren't actually getting enough training to feel like they could really put themselves forward. So I think specifically in relation to how we support our young advisors group, we have really changed the infrastructure around that and thought very carefully about how to better support them to be involved in scrutiny of our work in our own governance processes and understanding that.
Thank you.
Thank you. Liam Kerr, back to yourself again. Thank you.
Yeah, it's a not unrelated point, actually, that I'd like to ask about, and something that you've both talked on already. I was really pleased to see just how wide the consultation was, and we saw it on the video, just how many views were taken in, and the voice that you gave to children and young people. So how, going forward, do you propose to communicate with not only those who contributed, but children and young people more widely on how much progress is being made?
I'll touch on a couple of ways that we're planning at the moment. So we're throughout the strategic plan and in their ways of working, we're trying to look at ways that we can work broadly on broad systemic issues and also very targeted with particular groups of children and young people at times that are necessary, and bringing them into their voice into some of that systemic issue work, and also thinking about that and how do we communicate and how do we work with children and young people. So moving forwards, we're looking at, for example, I would love to talk to you at the appropriate time about the work that we're planning around about education. And there will be groups of children and young people that we feel their voices are underrepresented within the ongoing discussion at the moment. So we'll be thinking, we are planning to do some very specific work about building stronger relationships, having targeted support and engagement with our office. And that will be built in throughout. So there'll be some groups of children and young people where we continue to very much be about either myself or members of our team connecting with those young people or groups that work with them to have either in-person or ongoing feedback. But we're also continuing to think about actually what's our role more broadly and how do we communicate with children and young people. So the engagement plan that we put together for the strategic plan allowed me to experiment a little bit with different ways of communicating with children and young people as well. So hopefully you might be aware that we were doing some online assemblies, you know, and we had 7,000 children and young people attended that on that one day. So we're also looking at ways like this as well. So we already have our website, we have our social media content, but actually, where are children and young people and how can we use some of the infrastructure that we already have to have an ongoing communication loop with them so that we are absolutely making sure that we're keeping them updated, that we continue to promote their rights to them and the adults that work with them, but also they get the opportunity to continue to challenge us and ask us. So you've got the young advisors that we work with systematically. We have some groups of children and young people through thematic projects and pieces of work. There are groups of young people that we know are particularly vulnerable. So as part of our work, some of our team will be building ongoing relationships with those settings and looking at that broad infrastructure for ways of communicating.
Perhaps just on that very final point, the plan talks about supporting or prioritising those children and young people whose rights are most at risk. Can you talk a little more about that, about perhaps how you will assess who that is and what that actually means as it takes shape?
So again, we're looking at this through different lenses. So for example, if I talk a little bit about the education piece of work, when we were doing our engagement plan, we looked at through our child rights impact assessment and also by looking at the analysis of consultation with children and young people that had already happened, we were actually doing an assessment, a gap analysis of where are children and young people actually already being asked for their views, where do they already have a conduit to support them to give their views, and where are there particular gaps in that. So we identified groups of children and young people that actually there were not a huge amount of consultation or evidence that we were able to find, and therefore that's how we approach targeting some of our in-person work through the engagement sessions. So we're going to continue to look at that again through some of the thematic pieces of work that we're going to do. So for education again, we're going to have another look at that gap analysis and see actually across education, what can we find already? Where are there well-represented groups? They will be part of the conversation, but actually, where do we have to do more work? And that might be us doing that work, but it also will be us ensuring that others are aware of those gaps as well. So can, you know, approach that. We need everyone, you know, together to be able to address this. So one thing I should mention is that we're publishing another paper within the next 2 months, which is an evidence paper, which will give you all of the information about all of the groups we worked with, what children and young people told us and how that's informed the strategic plan as well. And then there are some groups of children and young people that we've already been working with over the years and we understand already that they're very vulnerable. In terms of children and young people, so there will be some ongoing work. So it's a combination of the child rights impact assessment that we have undertaken already and we will update, and we'll be using that to look at the gap analysis of actually where do we think there are children and young people that either there's ongoing relationships will sustain, or there are actually some concerns that their views aren't already understood, or there's a need to ensure that they have got some support to understand their rights. to understand how they can, you know, advance those, have access to justice around about that. So it's quite a systematic approach, ultimately, is what I'm trying to say.
Very grateful. Thank you. Convener.
Thank you very much, Liam Kerr. Now, back to you, Ruth Maguire.
Thank you, Convener. I wanted to ask about the UNCRC, and could you talk to what work your office is doing to ensure that public bodies and schools are ready for the commencement of the UNCRC Act?
Great, thank you. So at a very high level, this absolutely informs all of our work, and hopefully that comes through the strategic plan as well. As I mentioned earlier, implementation now is going to be a key focus for us. A lot of the work that we'll do around about promoting children's rights will focus on UNCRC and continuing to ensure that children and adults understand that. And as you'll be aware, our office will be one of the statutory consultees in terms of looking at the Child Rights Scheme. I'm just going to pass over to Gina and see if there's anything you wanted to add.
We sit as a member of Scottish Government's Strategic Implementation Board on the UNCRC as well, so that we're kept up to date on where public bodies feel that they are in terms of preparedness and the resources that are being created to support them in their readiness as well. And we are at the moment reviewing the guidance that's been created for public bodies, and we'll be responding on that in a couple of weeks' time. It's probably useful to be aware of the work that we're doing around our legal power, so I'll pass to Nick to say a little bit about that.
Yeah, so we're obviously, although the delay to passage of the UNCRC bill was frustrating, the one positive of it was it gave us a window of opportunity to think about how we wanted to use the litigation powers, and we've taken that opportunity to develop a strategic litigation toolkit with the involvement of experts in strategic litigation, and a project that draws on experience of global children's rights litigation, and that helps us to set out the way in which we're going to make decisions on strategic litigation cases, which cases we're going to take in what circumstances, and make sure that we ourselves are litigating in a way that's child rights compliant. It's also obviously really important to say that we don't want to litigate if we don't have to, and so we would expect to be taking an approach with public authorities where we might be raising issues, but in the hope that we wouldn't need to end up in court, that they would take that opportunity to rectify whatever issue we're raising and identifying with them.
Assessment of the sort of volume of issues that might be out there at the moment.
It's difficult to tell what's going to come through the door. I mean, I think we are probably expecting a significant number of contacts with the office, I would say. Not all of those will be cases that could be taken. So I'm sure people will be approaching us, as they do now, with issues and frustrations about how they or their children are being treated by public bodies that may not kind of fit within the scope of the UNCRC Act, or may not be litigation, and we'll have to be very sensitive to how we deal with those. Some of them will be cases that relate solely to individual children and young people, and we'll want to make sure that we're able to support and signpost people to the appropriate routes to get legal advice and support to take those cases themselves. The cases that we want to take are the ones that are going to have the most impact, so those that offer the opportunity to change the law, to establish precedents, to address issues where there are systemic rights breaches that affect maybe large numbers of children or perhaps a smaller group of children, but in a really fundamental way. So that's why we've taken that step of developing the decision-making framework, is so that all of the decisions we make are really clear and transparent and accountable and grounded in children's human rights standards. I mean, we're going to find out very shortly what the volume of cases is going to be, and that'll be that's both kind of really exciting for us.
Are you confident you have the capacity to deal with the volume of inquiries, if you're not sure how many there will be?
I mean, we'll find out very shortly. It was never going to be the case that we were able to take every children's rights case in Scotland. We were always going to have to make really careful and deliberate, and often, I suspect, very difficult decisions about what cases the office is able to take forward. But the proof will be in the pudding very, very shortly.
And for the benefit of the record, I guess, and for setting people's expectations, because that will be important, that people don't have the incorrect expectation of what you can achieve. Who do you anticipate, or who should be in touch with the office to highlight any cases that they feel reflect systemic issues?
We've already been talking to, and we'll continue to talk to, the legal profession. So through a number of different areas, there's a children's rights strategic litigation network that we're very engaged with. And so we've been reaching out and speaking to solicitors. We'll be developing work with members of the Faculty of Advocates. And so we would expect that the majority of cases that we're likely to take forward ourselves will be coming from legal practitioners rather than from members of the public.
Is there any assessment that, or I suppose, how would you reflect on that approach in terms of sometimes those whose rights are being impinged on or not realised are actually have the least capacity to engage the legal profession? How do you address that?
Yeah, it loops back to the comment that both Gina and the Commissioner made earlier on about making sure that through the work that we're doing, we reach out to those communities of children and young people who we've identified as being most at risk, because part of the reason for that, of course, is exactly the point that you make about those are the ways in which we might be able to identify potential avenues for use of our formal powers of investigation or litigation.
Okay, thank you. Holding duty bearers accountable for decision-making and delivery of commitments to children is outlined as a strategic objective in the plan. How will you do that?
So, first of all, this has always been part of the role of Commissioner, to be a champion for children and young people and to be looking at who is accountable and responsible for delivering on children's rights. So it's clear one to continue to do. In terms of how we'll go about that, it will take different forms and in different moments. So I think how people are held to account or how duty bearers are held to account depends on what the issue is and when that's happening. So to give you an example of different ways, it may be actually about one-to-one meetings, having conversations. The office sometimes, if they identify an issue, will write to particular duty bearers and ask for an explanation around about things. Sometimes it can be a more public challenge, if appropriate. So I'll continue to take the approach actually about looking at what actually is the issue, who is responsible, are we aware of who's responsible? Because sometimes some of the challenges for children's rights and services is it's not always clear. There are many, many different ways of doing that, and we'll continue to assess what's the most appropriate way at the right time. Another thing that I'd like to mention, though, is that we are looking at sometimes how challenging it is to understand when commitments that have been made to children and young people have been delivered or not, and how to hold that kind of accountability. So we are looking at the creation of trialling a more complex accountability tracker. So, for example, you'll see in the strategic plan that young people have really strongly identified these top three themes of education, poverty and mental health. So we're looking at some thematic long-term pieces of work around those. In terms of mental health, this is the first piece of work we're going to look at, an accountability tracker. To explain this a little bit more, you'll be aware of this sometimes, if I use Scottish Government as an example, as a duty bearer, there will be recommendations made and commitments made by government. And sometimes then those commitments will result in additional reports, additional action groups set up. There'll be minutes from those, there'll be actions for those. So sometimes when you're trying to follow the thread through of when was a commitment made to children and young people and what's happened with it, it can become very, very complex trying to track that through in all of the different ways and who's responsible for that. So we're going to be looking for mental health in particular across the board, actually, to say actually what have been the commitments that have been made to children and young people across multiple policy areas that relate to the services to support their mental health. How can we track that better so that therefore whenever we are having conversations, meetings, and we can see that there are deadlines, we're absolutely crystal clear and we can share that with others as well.
OK,
skills for that work? I think it will take us a while to get that first tracker up and running. So we're, you know, again, I'm really keen with the team in terms of these big, meaningful, longer term pieces of work that we take the time to do them well. So we're looking at that within year one. So by the end of year one, we would like to have it there, up and running, testing if we're able, if it's useful and it's really making a difference to our work. Longer term, if we can make it useful, we would also like to see whether it's possible we can make that public as well. And that in itself will help us to hold duty bearers to account, but should actually help children and young people and adults that are working with them to be able to do that as well.
Thank you. And a last question, if I may, convener. People will rightly look to your office, Nicola, to really fiercely champion children's rights. And I think all of us around this table would acknowledge that although as a headline we all support rights of children, everyone wants to see them upheld, when we get into the details of legislation or even policy, I guess, or policy choices, budget choices, rights do come into conflict. How will your office assist in dialogue around that and contribute to ensure that there's, I suppose, that the discussions about rights are meaningful and that interaction is spoken about?
So I have been really pleased with, you know, coming into the role and seeing how the office works, about the level of engagement and involvement with Parliament, MSP briefings that we provide, and that ongoing contribution. So that will absolutely continue as part of our ongoing work. So where there are complex issues and where we assess that we have the skills, the knowledge and the capacity to be able to contribute towards that, then we will continue to do that and want to help as much as possible. We absolutely recognise that when it comes to human rights, it is complex, can be really complex, and that the necessary debates have to happen within Parliament. And we want to continue to do that and, you know, provide briefings where we can, and also, you know, have meetings and conversations in any ways that we can help. I just want to check in and see if Nick or Gina have got anything you want to add.
Just very briefly further to that, how do you have those conversations with children and young people?
Mm-hmm. So in terms of my experiences of working with children and young people over many years and my experiences over the past 6-7 months in this role, children and young people are often much better than us, you know, in terms of adults that are having these conversations. So I think in age-appropriate ways, well-supported, a lot of our work is often about allowing young people to lead the discussion as well. You know, so the engagement plan that we were doing over the past 6 months was about encouraging children and young people to tell us what the issues were. We weren't necessarily going to them with some of the kind of really challenging issues that are going on at the moment, but we're saying, tell us what the issues are. But I think that there are ways that children and young people can be brought into discussions. They're often really excellent at listening to others. And being so well supported, appropriate time, age appropriate ways to be able to involve them as and when it's appropriate to do so.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ruth McGuire. Can we now come to questions from Bill Kidd, please?
Thank you very much, convener, and thank you for everything that you've outlined. Now, you've pretty much covered a certain degree of this, but when it comes to promoting access to justice for breaches of children's rights, because that's a commitment in the plan, who are you going to approach in terms of how that can be, or those can be resolved? I mean, because it's fine, and I'm not saying this is what you're doing, but it's fine to say that this is wrong and we're going to sort it out, but how do you sort it out, and who do you approach to actually sort of bring on board in legal terms if it comes to that, please?
So I'll start and then I'm going to pass over to Nick. So again, this has been a piece of work that's been ongoing, and what's changed is over the past few years and coming is that we have additional legal powers to be able to approach this in different ways. So some of the work that's happened historically has been exactly as I've actually outlined, that we, if there is a particular issue, we can identify who the duty bearer is. We might make an approach directly and challenge that, you know, directly. And that can be through meetings, it can be through letters. It might be an approach to say, actually, who is the group that's responsible for setting principles or standards for a certain issue, and is it appropriate from a children's rights lens that we are the right organisation that would challenge and approach that as well. And the office has had many successes over the years with that approach. With the addition of legal powers, we've also, that has given, somebody described it in the consultation as the office more teeth, you know, on behalf of children and young people to actually say, we want to explore this more in advance of using the legal powers as well, which has also been really useful. But again, I just want to pass over to Nick to see if there's anything more in terms of our newer powers that you'd like to add.
I think it's important to think about and understand where the office sits in the broader access to justice landscape as well. So, as I touched on earlier, just the scope and scale of the office's resource means that it's not appropriate for us to be the only route through which children are able to access remedy and redress. And obviously what that landscape looks like depends on the particular issue that you're considering. So within ASN, additional support needs, for instance, you've got the tribunal process which exists. That doesn't exist in other areas. So it's important for children to be able to understand the different routes through which they might be able to seek remedy for a potential rights breach, and then be able to access the support that enables them to do that. The Scottish Government at the moment is doing some work on non-judicial routes to remedy. So that will be, I think, has the potential to be really positive in terms of providing children and young people and those who support them with a bit more of a roadmap around the different routes through which you might be able to raise and resolve issues. And our office is obviously kind of part of that in terms of the legal powers that we have for those systemic, really significant rights breaches. But it's also about making sure that remedy is available as close to the child as possible. You know, you don't want to have a child have to go through a very complex legal process if actually the issue can be resolved, you know, very, very quickly and very, 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 very close to them. That is going to require, I think, quite a holistic assessment of where the gaps might be, particularly around things like advocacy and legal advice and representation. And we're doing a piece of research at the moment, which we're hoping to publish fairly shortly, which is helping to map out the advice and advocacy provision across Scotland for children and young people, which will help to inform us about where the gaps are and where we might want to put some of our resource.
Okay. Thank you. That's really useful, actually. And I suppose it fits in with the strategic plans statement that the Commissioner's Office will work as an independent children's rights institution, because you need to have a sort of focal point and a place that people know that they can go, in order that if there are, A, they need to know what the rights are, but B, if there are people or organisations which breach these, they need somebody of expertise to know what direction to head in to have that resolved. Is this approach then, this is what you're going to take in order to uphold children's rights going forward, and have you got an idea as to a scale, time scale sort of idea? Or?
In terms of approaches, so I think the strategic litigation and legal powers is just one part of it. So the way that we're hopefully presenting the strategic plan is to show the connection between them all. In terms of timescale, the new powers will commence this summer. We've been preparing to operationalise those. So we would imagine at some point this year, you know, we would see those coming into fruition and us, you know, moving forwards with that. However, our approach to protecting, promoting children's rights is actually about everything that we're doing. It's that continued education. It's that continued insurance that we understand across Scotland how children are really, you know, enjoying their rights and realising those. It's the continuation of targeted work with children, young people and those that work with them to ensure that we've got that feedback loop. And then looking at the different skills, functions and powers that the office holds and selecting what's the most appropriate at the right time.
To me, thank you very much indeed. That's helpful. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. It's questions from myself now, Commissioner. I suppose before I sort of ask specifically about the promise, I was wondering in terms of those that you consulted, in terms of the care experienced children, I'm looking for some sort of more information about how you involve them in developing your strategy.
So the strategy itself and how we involved children, young people, and I will touch on care experienced young people within this, is, as I mentioned initially, we looked at what consultations had already taken place. So there is a huge body of work around about the independent care review, the work of The Promise, Who Cares Scotland. So that work was already included in an initial desk-based analysis. We then worked on our smart survey, where we wanted to sense check those key themes that children and young people had identified. So we distributed that as widely as we possibly could, and that was through schools, that was through youth clubs, informal settings, as well as online. And then we had our targeted, either in-person or online work. And again, through that, we worked with some care experience groups, and we had some care experienced young people who were present within mixed groups that we worked with as well. What was really, really interesting for us across all of the groups we worked with, particularly within the targeted groups, is how recurring the themes were around about the themes that you see in here. So education, regardless of which group of children and young people and what their particular circumstances were, they all wanted to talk about their experiences of education. So that was, again, why that's come out so strongly within the selection for the strategic plan.
It was interesting. We had, prior to recess, we had a session with some young people through facilitated by Who Cares Scotland, and it was quite a frustrating session for us to hear what we were from these young people, and there will be a note published of that that I would certainly direct your office to take great cognizance of and have a look at. And they mentioned, you just send out a survey and then we never hear from you again specifically, and perhaps that's the survey. We didn't quite get to understand what survey it was that they were referring to. Maybe it was yours. But so what role do you see the Commissioner's office in relation to keeping the promise by 2030? Because the feedback we were getting is that that's quite some way. Yep. It's quite aspirational.
So there's, I guess, the sort of high level responsibilities that we'll take as a corporate parent, and also continuing to, where appropriate, contribute towards scrutiny. You'll remember I was in as part of an evidence session recently around about The Promise, and raising our concerns as well about that need for the detailed implementation plan. So continuing to add our voice, actually, to support for the work that is required to be done, the need for the detailed implementation plan. And also, I know that there's been calls for actually understanding the investment plan that will go alongside that. The work in our thematic areas as well will be part of our commitment to actually looking at, again, as I mentioned earlier, children across the board talk to us about their experiences of education. And as we're all aware, you know, children and young people who are care experienced can have poorer outcomes across many different ways, and education being one of those. And that's why we're looking at a really long, you know, whole system, children-led, look at education, and actually how can we now look very visionary, whole system, at what needs to change. So we will be absolutely planning for a number of groups to be shaping that and be part of that with us, and I anticipate that care experienced young people will be part of that as well.
I suppose I can't speak too much around the detail, but what we did hear was that the promise is great, but there was always generally a but afterwards. And it's great to have a visionary and a whole system approach, but when that comes to how that impacts on young people, that's quite disconnected from reality. So I was wondering, in terms of monitoring progress on the ground, what will your office be doing that, and what work will that involve? Just so, you know, so we've got the evidence to challenge the reality.
So within the strategic plan, again, it will be a general ongoing looking at monitoring. You know, you'll see in our objectives that we do have an ongoing commitment to continue to monitor law, policy and practice. So the work of The Promise will continue to be of importance. We will continue to monitor that, and at times, if appropriate, we may add and contribute towards that. But I guess our key commitment within our strategic plan is about looking at what are some of the services that children and young people who are care experienced are experiencing day to day, and where are they not working for them. So again, pointing towards the work around about education, this is a really, you know, children have said to me so strongly there are so many things that can be better about the education system. We recognise that their voices are not as heard within the current debate. So there's been excellent work that has happened over the past few years in terms of commissioning really great reports and reviews around about this. So that, I guess, is our
I know we've got members specific around the education reform agenda. I've got colleagues coming in with that theme, so you'll be able to elaborate then. Okay. I've got a couple of supplementaries. I've got Willie Rennie first, and then we'll come to Pam Duncan.
I mean, I want to be blunt. They were pretty angry when we met them, and they think nothing really has changed. They think there's a lot of talk, and there's a lot of plans, a lot of documents, a lot of surveys, but nothing really happens. And that's why they're angry, they're cynical, they're sceptical, and they gave us a pretty hard time because they think we're part of the problem. Are you angry about it as well? I mean, are they right to be angry, and are you sharing that anger with those in positions of power?
So I am frustrated about what more can be done for all children and young people in Scotland, including care experienced young people. And it will be part of my role to share that frustration on behalf of children and young people, you know, as and when it's appropriate. So I hope that helps to answer. It's part of my responsibility to hold duty bearers to account. When I met with children and young people who are care experienced, they talked to me about a number of things that were really challenging for them right now. So I think that whilst we've seen from the work and the progress around about work of the province, there are, as you'll be very aware of, great examples of progress. But what we aren't great at is systematically embedding change and allowing all children and young people to be able to feel that change, and all care experienced children and young people to feel that change. Okay. So there is much more that needs to be done.
So give me an example of great progress on the promise and very poor progress or no progress.
So this actually wasn't part of the engagement that came out for the strategic plan. But when I met with some care experienced young people in advance of that, examples that they gave me were around about supports for through care and feeling positive.
That's a good example.
Progress.
Okay. Right.
So that is a good example. Also, the support that I know that has been, you know, pilot programmes that have developed around about actually care for pregnant mothers, you know, that holistic support. So I think these are areas that you're aware of as well. You know, there are these examples across Scotland, but we are still struggling not just with the promise, but I think across, you know, many areas of children's services to take good examples and good pilots and then systematically embed them throughout our services, which is why, again, in this strategic plan, we're really interested in implementation. So we've got lots of good legislation, emerging legislation, we've got great policies, but actually how does it convert into the reality for children and young people on the ground?
So you're thinking the lack of spreading good practice is the bad example, or have you got anything else that they should be angry about and are right to be angry about?
I think any child or young person who's having difficult experiences right now has the right to be angry, and I feel so pleased that those young people felt capable and able as well to come in here and tell you exactly how angry they are. So the lack of ability to spread is an example of how much better we have to get at actually enabling that to happen throughout systems. But I have heard many other examples from children and young people, including care experienced young people, of how we're still not getting it right in many different ways. Some of that, again, will be published within the evidence paper that we're going to publish in about 2 months, Gina, just checking with you. And again, there'll be lots of evidence within that.
Thanks. Pam Duncan-Glancy, thank you for your patience. Over to
thank
yourself
you.
Now.
Thank you, Convener. No problem at all. Thank you and good morning. Thank you for everything you've said so far, and also for the video, which I found really interesting and a nice way to put across the points that the young people have made. Sticking with the theme of sort of laws, policies and practice and the broader picture, obviously we've spoken there about the promise, and young people really were angry. I mean, I think one young person said near the end of the session we had, you know, they might as well name it something different, which really struck me. In your strategic plan, you highlight that the aim of your organisation is that laws, policies and practice will fulfil children's rights. In addition to the promise, are there any other laws, policies and practice that you're concerned about in terms of fulfilling children's rights?
So I will highlight education. and if appropriate, I could talk more about the...
It's fine. The supplementaries might feed into that from sure. Mr. McPherson.
So children and young people's, you know, children and young people in their ways talk to us about lots and lots of different ways of how they are not at the moment experiencing all of their rights. Okay, so there are many, many different ways. And we've chosen to focus on the themes throughout here because they were very consistent. So as I mentioned earlier, we worked with numerous targeted groups. This included asylum seekers and refugees, care experienced young people, disabled young people, young carers, many groups, again, which will be clear in the evidence paper that we're going to publish. But the remarkable consistency was how strongly those children and young people wanted to talk to us. And we're concerned about their experiences within education, but also their experiences relating to poverty, the cost of living crisis, worries about their friends that were experiencing that as well. So if I touch on one of the big thematic pieces of work that we're planning to do, ultimately, in fact, two of those thematic pieces of work, when we're looking at education, what we are going to commit to is actually putting children and young people's voices back at the centre of the discussion around about education reform. So our commitment within this strategic plan is that we, in the work plan that follows it, is that we're going to create a set of principles and priorities with children and young people for education reform in Scotland. This will take us a number of years. So again, when we've been looking and reflecting on some of the most impactful work that the office has been able to do over the years, it has been looking at what are really systemic issues that will take a long time to change, and how can we approach and add value by bringing together different organisations, children and young people, and those that are trying to work on this. So in terms of how we're planning to go about this, our plan is, as I mentioned earlier, to look at where do those children, young people who are furthest away from enjoying all of their rights within the current education system. We're going to do a systematic review of actually where are their groups and those who can support them to contribute really well, and actually where have we still got some young people whose voices are not as well heard within that as well. We're going to work to build relationships and trust with those groups of young people, and based on how they feel they would like to be involved, is try to create a way in which they can have their voice heard, and we can look at all of the different issues across the whole system within the education system. That will result in us creating child-friendly collaborative spaces where we are looking at education professionals across the board from the formal and informal sector, involving academics as well, involving those youth workers, creative practitioners, to come together and to listen to the voices of children and young people who are furthest away from enjoying the education system, and beginning to work together on actually how do we create that education reform agenda with those core principles defined by children and young people. So this is a key strategic piece of work that we are planning to begin now, and will take us some time, but we think is absolutely critical to ensure that children and young people retain at the core of the education reform agenda. I should say that we absolutely recognise that there are lots of amazing educationalists, teachers, support workers who are trying and working extremely hard There are many children and young people who are having really positive experiences just now within schools and our education setting, but there are many who are not. So it's really important in this role that we are really honest about that. We express how strongly children and young people have asked me to work on this and as an office to work on this. And we're really excited about developing those links with those groups to bring them back into the conversation. Some of the reports, the Ken Muir report, the Morgan review, excellent pieces of work, and they really stressed the need for children and young people's voices to be listened to and to be connected into this. So we know we're not starting from scratch as well, but we want to look at some of those groups that actually haven't been enabled to do that and try our absolutely best to ensure that we can, wherever possible, bring them into that.
Thank you. Thank you, convener. Am I okay to continue? Thank you. On that particular point around education, is there anything? Well, first of all, did you say a couple of years for the timescales for that?
We are hoping that we'll have this created within 2 years.
Okay.
But the first part of that work will be about identifying those groups and building trusting relationships and setting that up. So there'll be lots of different strands, and we'll be defined by children and young people, but that's the timescale that we're setting at the moment.
Okay, and in terms of specifics on any issues within education, mental health and poverty, as you highlighted, is that the paper that you're going to publish in a couple of months?
So the paper we're going to publish in a couple of months is our evidence paper, which will share with you what children and young people have said throughout that entire engagement process. And we also have a paper where we'll be looking at actually within our education system, what does the legislation say, what does policy say, and how do we set that against actually what are the issues that children and young people have recognised with us. What we're also looking to do over the next few months is look at actually the issues that children and young people have identified and how might we code them against the current education system as well. So actually what is about clarity of purpose of the system, what is actually about training and support for staff working within the system, what is about resource. So that won't be published by the summer, but the evidence paper will, but that's another piece of work that we're starting at the moment.
Okay, that's really helpful. I'm hearing that, as well as some concerns that were highlighted earlier on, the promise education is really kind of up there in terms of concerns around laws, policies and practices that would fulfil children's rights. Okay, thank you. The next question I have is around funding, if that's all right. So could you maybe set out what monitoring your office will undertake to understand the impact of tightening financial settlements for the government and local authorities on children and young people?
So we're very specifically going to be looking at this from the poverty lens. So we are, again, from the poverty piece of work, you'll see that we're looking very interested in actually what's the connection between decisions that are made about funding, particularly for this piece of work at a local level. We'll have some links into national work, the fact that the Child Poverty Action Plan needs to be, you know, renewed by 2026. We'll be looking at how children and young people are involved in that as well. But we will be taking a kind of in-depth focus look at actually how are decisions being made and how are children's voices visible and taken into consideration when voices and services are funding decisions are made around about that. So our piece of work that we're looking at, a thematic piece of work looking at poverty, is very specifically looking at actually what is important to children and young people that are experiencing poverty, how is that understood, and how is that connected or not to decision making at a local level. So not at the moment looking at the totality of resources at the moment across all of Scotland, but actually taking a really in-depth look at certain communities across Scotland and how children and young people are experiencing poverty within those and how that connects or not to decisions that are made about them.
That's helpful. And do you think that that will include looking at differentiation and how some of these policies might impact on specific groups like care experience groups or disabled people?
Mm-hmm. Gina?
We have written out to all local authorities and asked them if they could share with us what consideration they've given to children's rights with the current budgets that they've set. What we're doing with the analysis of that, we won't be looking specifically at budget lines, but we're trying to look at what assessment have they made of children's rights and have any particular protected characteristics been considered within that. We're hoping to try and do the analysis of that and maybe publish in about summertime what that looks like, but to try and give a bit of a picture to what extent children's rights and protected characteristics have even been considered at a local level when budget decisions have been made. So that will feed into the longer term piece of work that the Commissioner was describing there. But we at the moment don't really have any kind of picture about to what extent at a local level children's rights have been considered.
And have you been concerned about any decisions you've seen in that particular space?
Concerned overall about reduction in budgets. I'm concerned about the impact that has. I think that you'll be very aware of this. You know, almost all sectors that work with children and young people are raising concerns around about reducing budgets and the impact that that has on them. And non-statutory services are particularly vulnerable within that. So again, services such as youth work, you know, many children and young people often can identify, or we want them to be able to identify, a trusted adult, that it can make a huge difference to them. So general concerns around about ongoing that reduction in opportunities for children and young people, how those choices are made around about them, whilst we have workforce across many different areas really saying we need support, we need investment.
Thank you. Is there room for one more? Mm-hmm. Thank you. I was also wanting to ask a question about your budget. And in your paper, you say that the budget you've outlined is the minimum required to deliver our current statutory functions, but there's some unpredictability. Could you tell us a bit about what that unpredictability is and what conversations you're having with the government about that?
So what we really wanted to ensure is that we were really transparent about the fact that the new legal powers that were taken on, they are new. And, we were asked earlier a question around about level of ask for that and how. So we're having some really pragmatic, this is a pragmatic budget for us, where we're actually saying that we will be looking at what do we have the capacity to be able to do. So that's the budget that we've put together. We will be making choices on that, but actually we do anticipate that over the next year to 2 years, we'll have a much better understanding of what could be possible. So it was really important for us to say, actually, we will, you know, we'll work really hard as a team to cope with the allocation that we have. We're very conscious of the difficult financial climate that we all operate within. But these are new powers. There will be opportunities for children and young people that come within that. So therefore, we will approach, Scottish Parliament corporate body really over the future as we understand that better and see whether there's an opportunity for more. So it was really just about being transparent about that whilst working really sensibly and pragmatically as well.
Thank you. I appreciate that. Thanks very much.
Nicola, can I go back just a little bit just to ask, you spoke about some of the decisions that are going to be made around budgets and how you will always advocate for like youth work, etc. But how do you help young people understand the decisions that are being taken? Because they'll not understand why. So is there work that you're doing to perhaps help them?
The work that I think is really important for us to do is to probe and challenge on whether that's happening at a local level. We're really interested in how systematically children and young people are involved in decision making. So that's a big feature for us in this strategic plan. And whether that's systematically embedded and whether that's been done in an age-appropriate way and whether there is a feedback loop on that. We find that children and young people are able to understand complex issues. They can understand when, if there's not enough money to do everything, that choices have to be made. But we often see them not being included in that. So that when we wrote out to local authorities recently, that really was an inquiry on our behalf to say, actually, how have you included children and young people in ensuring that they know what choices are being made? So the role that we will take across the board will be to continue to highlight good practice where that's happening well, but to continue to probe and push for children and young people to be included in conversations and for that to be done in a really appropriate, child-friendly way with the appropriate timescale for conversations to be able to have and that to be understood. And then we will very specifically look at this in detail through our thematic work within the poverty area.
Thanks. Thank you very much. Ben McPherson.
Thank you, convener. Good morning. So it's already been touched on how you plan to influence education reform, what your what areas of that are of priority to you and why you want to influence them. If there's anything more you want to add about education reform, please do. But I appreciate you've already touched on that with Pam Duncan Clancy. But I was also interested in priorities you may have in terms of post-school education reform. Obviously, we've had the Withers Review as well. So just grateful for any of your thoughts, Commissioner, or colleagues.
Yeah. So I'll pass over to Gina in a second to respond a little bit more on our behalf. But one thing I would say in terms of post-school, we did have young people involved in the consultation who were currently attending school or currently attending an education setting in some way. And we had some young people who were at college. And there were so many positive examples that they were drawing on in terms of the approaches that they were experiencing in college. They were able to draw out some really key differences within that. And how they felt as if the holistic education system could benefit from some of the good examples and positivity within that. Within the strategic plan, from a thematic point of view, we aren't starting with post-school destinations in terms of college or further education. We will be looking at the primary and secondary school as a starting point, but be continuing to look at any good examples. Gina, anything you want to add?
Yeah, I think it's a really interesting question, and we would really hope to have further and higher education professionals involved in those discussions with us, because that transition through all stages of education has come out really strongly to us from children and young people about being something that they find can be limiting in some ways. Sometimes that's what's driving the exam system that we have or the process that children and young people feel they have to go through at secondary school. So we will try to look at it in the round. We will probably look particularly with the lens for care experience children and young people, because obviously our remit extends up to 21 for children and young people who have been care experienced. I think as our education focus develops, the post-school experience will probably be an area where we will specifically look at what's happening for care experienced children and young people and what can we learn from that that would be then applicable for all children and young people.
Okay. I presume considerations with regard to employers and the apprenticeship programmes over and above higher, not over and above, as well as higher and further education.
Very much. I think we're hoping that Nicola's described some of the child-friendly collaborative spaces that we're going to try and create over the next 2 years to look at education, what are children and young people saying that they really value. And I think you saw a little bit in the video that we showed earlier where we've heard so clearly we want to actually learn more life skills, we want to learn really valid skills at school. There's so much we can learn from the apprenticeship model and from the further education model that would be absolutely applicable right through education. I think we'll want to involve professionals from right across those spheres in those discussions.
And just in going back to schooling and the considerations around reform, I also really noted the part in the video about life skills, financial awareness. Are you going to seek to be pushing these issues in terms of education reform, curriculum changes?
So our starting point is that we're not looking to push single issues. We very much want to build the relationships with the children and young people. As I mentioned earlier, look at actually the data that we've already gathered. How would we initially code that? So life skills did come through strongly, but children and young people also talked about other elements within the curriculum where they felt that there were gaps or there were things were out of date. talked very much about how they learn. So as a starting point, we're not looking at pushing a single issue, but we will be looking at actually what are complex issues related to curriculum, what are complex issues related to teacher training. So that approach to begin with, and then that will evolve as we go into those spaces, talk, listen to children and young people, and involve that group, that sort of very diverse group of educationalists around about that.
As government's already got a lot to consider from the various reviews that have taken place in recent months and years, do you feel like the doors are open, so to speak, for you to feed in your thoughts as you just read them?
I very much hope so, and we've already been having a number of initial conversations with some senior civil servants. We've met with a number of other public bodies that are responsible for different elements of education. So we've had some initial conversations to see, actually, here is what children and young people are telling us. With UNCRC Act, you know, and being incorporated, here is what education should be from a children's rights perspective. Where are we on that journey? And kind of giving an initial steer towards the piece of work that we're planning, which is still in development stage. Those conversations have been very warm, you know, and very interested. And although earlier on Pamela mentioned that it will probably be a two-year piece of work, our intention will be to publish as we go. You know, so whenever we have a child-friendly collaborative space, the learning from that will be sharing. So there are many different organisations that we want to involve in this, and we want to create outputs as we go that we hope will influence.
Great. Thank you.
You've touched on this a little bit already there, Nicola, in terms of under the curriculum for excellence, and in particular the broad general education, teachers in schools are expected to determine the curriculum. And so how do you ensure that the schools are consistently within that education space directing towards the five elements listed in the UNCR Article 29?
So I think that I don't have a specific answer to that question. I think that, you know, will very much be a part of that broader conversation that we're going to enter into. We're actually going to look at actually how do teachers and support staff have all the information and resources and support that they need, and look at that through different lenses around about what training, initial teacher training, what CPD, longer term training is there. And so it's, again, I don't have a specific response to that one just now, because that will become part of the discussions that we want to have.
Okay, thank you. We'll look forward to seeing that develop then over the next wee while. Stephanie Callaghan, over to yourself now. Thanks.
Thanks very much, Convener, and thanks for coming along today. You're probably aware that of some of the themes from the committee's work that we've been undertaking recently, the additional support for learning, as well as the work around the transitions bill. And it's been quite clear that sometimes different services don't really work that well together. So I'm wondering if you've got any particular views on how public services could work together better to support the right outcomes for disabled children and young people.
So I guess in terms of the additional support for learning in disabled children, this is again something that's come up very strongly through the consultation that we've been doing, very aware of the inquiry that the committee's been undertaking and the learning from that. And in terms of how organisations can work together, part of that we will explore through this piece of work, you know, looking at education. So it will be very much about listening to children and young people's perspective on this, but also looking at some of the challenges that we already know are there. So we know there are challenges around about time. You know, so for professionals, we know there are challenges around about the need for partnership and collaboration needs to actually be planned and be supported by leadership and management. So I think there are quite a lot of ways that of working that are known. But what we're quite interested in getting to is that underneath that, okay, so why is that not happening? What would have to change to allow that to happen? And who's ultimately responsible for being able to create that change? So that's kind of an indication of how we want to dig quite deep when we look at this as well.
So I suppose perhaps something like, for example, coordinated support plans, that would be maybe something that you'd want to focus on. Would that be right?
Yeah, so coordinated support plans, we obviously are aware, are a big issue in terms of not being created for many children and young people. So an ongoing issue that we will continue to look at. And I imagine, yes, it will come out within this. But again, what we're really keen to do right now is not jump in to a particular issue, connect with the children and young people, focus on the issues also that they want to raise, and then bring people together to look at this from a, bring the issues together and say, actually, where do they sit? What's underneath them?
And make sure you're looking at the whole picture.
Yes, absolutely.
So I'm wondering as well, with the Learning Disability and Neurodiversity Bill coming forward and the possibility of a commissioner, I'm wondering if you've got plans to contribute or feed into that as it develops, or what you might already be doing or what you might be planning to do in the future.
Sure. So, yep, we will contribute towards the consultation on this. And I'm just going to pass over to Gina, who her team will lead on that.
We have had a number of discussions with the Scottish Government's team as they've been developing proposals around this. And we are looking at the moment to respond on the learning disability and neurodiversity proposals. Within that, which I imagine you're touching on as well, there's obviously a proposal for another commissioner. And we have spoken about our views on potential proposals for other new commissioners as well, and making sure that where those are taken forward, that any potential duplication or overlap of remits is reduced so that there's not additional complexity or confusion created for children and young people. That's probably one of the things that we're most concerned about, is that this is already a very confusing and adult-driven landscape for children and young people to know where they can go for support. We want to make sure that things are as simple as possible for them to know where they can get some support. So that will be part of our response on that bill as well.
So are there other challenges as well that you see around that possibility? Are there opportunities that you see in it to perhaps work together and do some crosswork? Or
there are no proposals with any of the new potential commissioners for our office to receive any additional resource to work with them. So I think there would be probably questions around how is it anticipated our offices will work together when we have a strategic plan, we are directed by children and young people, how would Parliament envisage that working? Will we all be asked to respond on the same issues? How will we ensure that there's that there is non-duplication between our offices? Because other commissioners may actually put a limitation on how we're able to use our powers, particularly our investigation powers. There are lots of considerations in there around what the impact might, unintended impact might actually be for existing offices around how we're able to fulfil our functions. I think you've probably heard from both my colleagues today how much of our focus has been on disabled children. We wouldn't want to see any limitation on the work that we're able to do in that area, particularly around additional support needs, which will be a really key theme as part of our education work. So we probably do have lots of questions and possible concerns about those proposals as they're coming through.
Okay, I think that's really good to hear. Your young advisors group as well, the video was absolutely excellent, and it was great to see such a wide range of children and young people being represented in that video there as well. And in your report as well, you've got that quote as well, that adults need to step back and see why our behaviour isn't great. There's always an underlying thing. And I'm just wondering, what kind of representation do you have from groups of young people with those particular challenges around additional support for learning, disabilities, etc. there? How is it that you look at that? Is it a kind of proportionate thing? Or is it something that you know, you balance out and sometimes there's a need to have more of them actually on the young advisors group? Or is it more about the young advisors group interacting with others in those groups and bringing things forward?
It's a little bit of both of those. So when we recruit for our young advisors, it's an open recruitment, so any young person can apply, but we do target specific organisations and ask them to see if there are any children and young people they're working with who might be interested, and we offer any additional support that's required to support them to engage with us. So if they needed a support worker with them, for instance, to be able to engage with us, we do say that we'll provide support to do that. So we try to make it as open as possible without, I'm trying to respect the confidentiality of our young advisors as well. We do have young advisors who do have additional support support needs within the group. We do try to have a group that's balanced and has as many different characteristics as possible, so that what we're getting in our young advisors group is a really broad range of experiences and views. But we recognise you cannot possibly cover everything within one single group of young advisors. So we do specific work with organisations who are supporting children and young people who we would want to make sure are engaged. So, for instance, if I can talk about one of the gaps that we have, we really wanted to have a young BSL user as part of our current standing young advisors group. We haven't been able to recruit one at the moment, but what we are doing is building our links with organisations who are working with groups of young BSL users, and we're doing targeted work with them. So where we recognise we have gaps, we're setting up relationships so that we're able to do targeted work with groups of young people that they're supporting to make sure that we're constantly hearing a diversity of views.
That's really helpful. It was great to see some BSL in your video too. Thanks.
The subtitles were too far for me to read them. I'll have to look at that later.
Yeah, I was struggling a bit.
Yeah. Ben McPherson, please. Now, back to yourself.
Thank you, convener. I just wanted to ask a question that Nick Hobbs has engaged with me on in terms of considerations with a debate. I had a members' debate on Scottish football in January. Just for transparency, Nick Hobbs and I had a meeting over the recess about this issue. And Nick, I just wanted to ask both further to, and Commissioner, apologies if it's okay if I ask Nick. Yeah. I just wondered if, following our meeting in recent weeks and also the debate in the chamber here, if you were able to update Parliament on your concerns around the way in which young people are considered within Scottish football and as economic assets, and your concerns about that, the Commissioner's Office's concerns about that.
I think it's striking that that this issue about how children are treated within football has now straddled the remits of three different children's commissioners, which probably gives you an indication of why we've arrived at the position that we've arrived at around seeing great force in the argument for independent regulation of football. And it's been because, despite a huge amount of work by the petitioners, Real Grassroots, who raised the issue originally, over a decade of work by the Parliament's Public Petitions Committee and work by our office, Scottish football and the SFA is still not at the place where it needs to be in terms of recognising children as rights holders within Scottish football and putting in place the protections from imbalanced legal relationships that need to be in place. So that's why we were very supportive when you had your debate of the argument around regulation. We remain supportive of that. I know there's a roundtable that's been committed to. We're really keen to see the outcome of that roundtable. And I think it is time for the Scottish Government to step in and think about either specific legislation around this issue or potentially a consultation about independent regulation for Scottish football. We'd be very supportive of seeing that happen.
And it's an issue about young people being contracted in law effectively and not being able to have the agency to move between clubs in a way that would be right and reasonable. That's where your concerns derive, isn't it?
Yeah, that's right. It's the imbalanced legal relationship between players and clubs, the power that gives to clubs, and the restrictions that places on children about where they go to play football.
And you'll be aware that in the members' debate, I proposed that, as well as the roundtable, which is happening, that I think it would be in the interests of all involved in the concerns and issues around Scottish football if there was a formal consultation undertaken by the government before the end of this parliamentary term. Is that something that the Children's Commissioner's Office would support?
Yes, very much so.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr McPherson. Now, Michelle Thompson. Thanks.
Good morning, everybody. Thank you for attending. And can I just put on the record that I enjoyed your wee video as well, and especially the use of the pentatonic scale for the young children. Just before I go on to my main thrust, I just wanted to pick up on something that my colleague Stephanie Callaghan was asking about in terms of the potential of another Commissioner for Learning, Disability and Neurodiversity. I'm assuming that you're aware that the funding for all the commissioners is top-sliced off the SPCB budget, therefore it's a law of diminishing returns that the more commissioners, the less there's going to be to go around given the budget constraints. I just wanted to check that you were aware of that, and did you reflect that in your submission to the recent research into the potential for a new commissioner?
So we've certainly reflected concerns around about allocation of budget and resources in our submission to the parliamentary inquiry around about commissioners, and you know, we'll, for the different commissioners, we'll reiterate those points. We are absolutely aware that there are so many issues that are still to be addressed for children, young people, and all people in Scotland in relation to disability and all the different reasons why those commissioners are being proposed. But it was really incumbent on us to be able to raise the concerns that we could foresee if there were additional offices brought into play and potentially not fully funded themselves for the expectations and potential powers that they were given, but also if that did have a negative impact on funding being reduced for our own office and our ability to promote and protect children's rights. So we have been quite open about that and will continue to be so.
Okay. The substantive point I wanted to move on to, I mean, obviously I've read your strategic document, and of course there's a lot of mention about children's rights, and rightly so. And the flip side, of course, is your responsibilities as an organisation. So I appreciate it's early days, but I wanted to ask what assessment you've made thus far of the implications of the CAS reviews on children's rights and your responsibilities therein.
So it is early days. However, the CAS review, I think, has raised some really important issues and in a really open way. The first one that I think is really important is around about the polarisation of the discussion and debate around about support and healthcare for young trans people. So first of all, I just wanted to highlight that for any trans, non-binary or children and young people that are questioning their gender identity at the moment in Scotland, I think it's so important right now that we can already see in the media and online that that nature of the discussion is inflamed again at the moment, and children and young people need absolute maximum support. There are also some important issues within there around about evidence and research gaps. So all children and young people have the right to have the highest attainable standards of health. And we would absolutely see that, that not just for trans young people, but across the board, that wherever there are gaps, that we would look to see that addressed. This was a report about England, but you know, I see that Scottish Government is looking at the report at the moment, so we will be interested to see what the response is. One of the things I thought would be helpful to raise as well, though, is that just a few weeks ago, and I think committee will be aware of it, the Royal Society Paediatric College has also published a report, Worried and Waiting, around about healthcare for all children and young people in Scotland. So whilst the CAS review has raised some really important issues, I think for the Scottish context, there are some really concerning systematic issues around about waiting times and lack of access to healthcare for, you know, many, many different children and young people across Scotland. So we're also you know, looking to see what Scottish Government's response is to that report. And again, as part of our ongoing work for monitoring law, policy and practice, we'll be looking to see actually what needs to be done and what is being done around about that across the board.
And of course, there is a consideration of safe access to healthcare. Article 33 of the UNCRC notes that children and young people have a right to be protected from harmful drugs. And one of the takeouts from the CAS review is the issues around the prescribing of puberty blockers to young children, the impact, you know, the state that it compromises bone density. So with that in mind, I appreciate it is early days and a number of organisations will need to be looking at that. But with that in mind, how alarmed do you feel about that? Whilst you've set out, you know, what trans and non-binary children might be looking for, against the potential for harm being administered to them by being given these drugs too early in their development, have you made any further assessment of this very specific issue rather than the general context we've talked about?
So it's not a specific issue that the office has worked on today, and I don't have a fixed view on that. What we would say is that Scottish Government are looking at this, and actually decisions around about medical care, you know, should continue to be made by medical professionals. But as part of our ongoing work to monitor law, policy and practice, we will be looking at what Scottish Government's response is.
OK, I'm sure we will all watch this area with interest. Thank you. Thank you, Convener. Thank you
very much, Michelle Thompson. And Willie Rennie, please.
So the Commissioner will have been aware of the debate that's currently taking place about behaviour, distress, violence in schools. And you'll also be aware that the Cabinet Secretary is preparing a report, an action plan. I'm interested to know what involvement you've had in the action plan, and particularly what your views on are some of the emerging issues around about exclusion, around about boundaries and consequences, about resources, but finally about the effectiveness of restorative practice. What's your take on all that?
Thank you. So any child, you know, any behaviour presented by children and young people is a form of communication, and all children and young people should feel able to be safe and feel well within educational settings. So I have already actually spoken out around about this and the need to understand the reasons for that distress behaviour. And this again has fed into why we are looking at education reform, because we don't believe that this can be solved, if solved is the right word to use, or progressed by looking at it with a single issue lens. So, you know, understanding our approach is very much about we have to understand why children display distressed behaviour when that happens. We have to ensure that the adults around about them have the right support that they need. And that will be sometimes teachers, sometimes support workers, sometimes it will be other adults working with children and young people. In terms of the specific around about the action plan, we haven't had a role in the development of that, although we had some attendance at the summits that were held by the Cabinet Secretary. But our key message is very much around about there are multiple complex challenges within our current system. It can be better, and that's why our contribution towards that is looking at this from a child's rights approach with children and young people, and what are the principles and priorities now that we have to take to be able to address these complex issues we're all aware of and move things on.
Just to be a wee bit more persistent about this, I did ask about resources, exclusions, about restorative practice and about boundaries and consequences. So I get the general thing and I get the understanding. I think that's the approach of understanding why young people behave the way that they are is really important. But we've also got to think about what everybody else in the class and the teacher experiences. So it's that balance between the two. How do we achieve that balance? And therefore, what is your view on those specific issues that I've mentioned?
In terms of all the children in the class, when I was meeting with children and young people, first of all, they did talk to me about ways that they were worried about each other, and they talked to me a lot about things that could be improved within the education system. I had to push them to talk about behaviour as being an issue because they weren't raising it. And actually, that's really what led to that quote you know, of a young person reacting to me pushing them and saying, but are you worried about behaviour? Because a lot of adults are talking about this just now, and that led to a really passionate young person saying, well, if adults are worried about that, they have to address what's underneath that. So essentially, we can prevent lots of challenging behaviours happening. We can prevent exclusions happening, but we have to have a system that is well-resourced, that is aligned to the purpose that we believe, that, you know, aligns with UNCRC, that is actually able to deliver on what Curriculum for Excellence did set up, you know, and hope for children and young people. So there is more to be done to be able to get to a point. We have much more understanding now around about children and young people's developmental needs, children and young people who are neurodiverse, and what they actually need within a particular setting to be able to support them. But that is not being implemented systematically throughout our system. And that's what we want to get to, is actually a plan and a vision with children and young people of how that can be. So I'm not trying to dodge, you know, very specific.
You are dodging.
But I think that the point that I'm really trying to make is that by answering and giving you a view on each one of them, I'm just going to keep coming back to the same issue, is that we have to connect all of these. We have to look whole system now. That's what we fundamentally believe, and that's the approach that we're going to take.
Okay, right.
If there's anything else you want to come in with, Willie, because Stephanie Callaghan's wanting a brief supplementary on this.
Thanks very much, convener. Yeah, just to pick up on what Willie was saying about boundaries and consequences and exclusions. You know, you've already said these things are kind of all linked together. And I suppose part of that as well can be bullying and a child who's continuing to be harmed and perhaps feeling that they can't attend school or having really big challenges around that. So I'm just wondering if your intention is to kind of zoom in and talk about these issues with young people and ask them to take that step back to and look at both sides of the equation, because we know as well that boundaries and consequences are actually really important for helping children and young people feel secure, and also for perhaps children whose behaviour is perhaps difficult, actually stopping them as well sometimes from spiralling into other behaviours that when they're looking back in a few years down the line, they're not looking over their shoulder and thinking, oh my goodness, you know, I can't believe it got to that point, or that I was responsible for things happening. So I'm just wondering if that's something that you've talked about and how to approach that.
So when we begin to develop the work around about education, first of all, it'll be about developing those relationships, trusting relationships. But it is very much important for us to allow children and young people to talk to us about the issues that they want to talk about. So it will be guided by them, and then we will be supporting, looking at actually what does that fall into, what are the different categories, and therefore how do we support that to be connected. So we'll be very much guided by children and young people. Bullying did come up a lot whenever we were doing the consultation with children and young people, and when we looked at what children and young people were actually saying, there were lots of ways of describing different examples of bullying that we feel were actually children and young people describing examples of discrimination. So we are interested in that through the education reform work that we're going to be doing as well, is actually looking at what are the incidents that are happening and how are we understanding them and what can be done to support that more. But I have to say that a lot of what children and young people did describe to me and us was a lot of broader frustrations around about supports that they required not necessarily being in place, what the ways in which things were being taught and the ability for that to be different. So as I mentioned again, the focus for the children and young people was actually saying there are different ways to do this and it could relieve pressure, it could help us all to be included. And they had lots of really good examples of that, not necessarily focusing so much on their behaviour. It was much more around about actually how could this be better for all of us.
Okay. Willie, are you?
I thought Stephanie summed it up really well, that actually the boundaries, the consequences, the frameworks, the apparatus that you create in a classroom keeps everyone safe. So this is not about punishment. I don't want to go back to the days when I used to get belted every second week at school. I don't want to go back to that. I want to have an understanding system, and that's a far, far, far superior way of doing it. But just now, there is a fear amongst teachers, pupils that I speak to, and there's lots of them that come to me and say it's intolerable in their circumstances, that it's got to change and there's got to be that boundaries and consequences and apparatus to make them all safe. And I'm disappointed you're dodging it. And I don't know why you're dodging that, because I think it's about every young person feeling safe. I get the bit about resources and support and dealing with the, rather than dealing with the symptoms, you've got to deal with the causes. I get all that. But that's not working just now. And it's not going to change overnight. So what else can we do to make sure that young people feel safe in the class?
So I absolutely agree that all children and young people should feel safe, and all adults that are working with us, with them within our education setting. And I also agree that, you know, appropriate boundaries, consequences, routines, they help children and young people to feel safe as well. So we don't disagree on that. But I think that what my job is to do is to ensure that you hear what children and young people have been able to say to me. And they have told me about examples where they have used a fidget toy to be able to support them with their coping, and they have been told off and shouted at because of that and made it to look away, you know, made asked to put it away. They have told me about examples where actually I found that many children and young people, they were actually developing coping strategies, and the system itself was shutting that down or wasn't recognising that for what it was. So I think it's so important in my role that my role is to actually come and say, but this is what children and young people have told me, and this is the choices that we're making around about how we will continue to bring them into a space where we can ensure that their voices are heard in this complex discussion about education. That's one of the concerns that I'm hoping that I've raised through the strategic plan objectives, is that, you know, we've had these great reports, we've heard people say children and young people need to be more centred within this. We're going to attempt to try and do that. So I'm sure we'll have lots of, you know, discussions to come.
Okay. Note of making sure children's voices are heard. I think we'll conclude our questioning session. And I'd like to thank you for your evidence this morning. And that concludes the public part of our proceedings. We'll suspend the meeting to allow our witnesses to leave, and then we'll move into private session to consider our final agenda items. Thanks very much.